50 years ago, Britain stood at bay, threatening her an enemy that had conquered Europe in a matter of weeks. Fifty years on, the enemies are allies. Young men from Britain, Germany and Italy now fly together. Their grandfathers fought against each other, often to the death. One of them became a NATO general. He flew fighters throughout the 5.5 years of World War II.
The battle always is with me sometime in my dreams. Sportive people were fighting a very fair fight, and the battle of Britain was a very fair fight between gentlemen. We are fighting the same kind of people. We are fighting the same breed of pilots, same education. There was no difference, I would think, but I tell you, it was extremely tough.
The duel in the sky is seen very differently by the British. They were defending their country.
During the Battle of Britain was the only time I really felt myself that a territorial possession. One used to look down and see one's own country, one's own people, and see these hideous great hordes of aircraft flying over. One thought, bloody hell, you know, I can't possibly allow this to happen.
They were bombing your country, and your one aim was to get up and slaughter as many as you could. There's nothing personal in it, you know. The chap you shot down, you didn't see him. I saw one who shot down. He was sitting in his cockpit and he went straight in. It didn't worry him in the slightest.
Cameras attached to the guns recorded the hits and the deaths. Earlier in that warm, bright summer of 1940, the jubilant Germans recorded on their home movie cameras the invader at play.
These are pictures of my wing after the surrender of France, and it has been very gay days. And so we played a very old song. It was a terrible music, and we had so much fun, and we hoped the war would be at end very, very, very soon.
Not for the first time, the British finished their game before getting down to the more serious business. Even then, it didn't look particularly serious. Life continued pretty much as normal in the seaside towns, though there were more uniforms about, and you couldn't get onto the beaches.
There was a line of anti-tank blocks of concrete and barbed wire entanglements all the way along the parade. And the beach was mined. Certainly you couldn't get onto the beach. Dogs that did occasionally got blown up when they managed to get through the wire and onto the beach.
Manning the beach defences were the local defence volunteers, the Home Guard.
There were sort of doctors, lawyers, city gents, a lot of retired generals and admirals, and just one or two youngsters who were waiting to get called up.
As May ended in the aftermath of Dunkirk, the British took stock. Perhaps the King best captured the mood. He felt relief, he said, relief that Britain was now free to fight on her own. And alone she was. Across the sea lay an enemy which so far had proved irresistible.
But we felt very strong, and Hitler was the greatest warlord of all times at that time. Propaganda machinery told us continuously.
Hitler was the man of the hour. Careless of the last enemy across the English Channel, he took time out to visit the scenes of his victories.
Actually, I was the first of the whole unit to arrive at the Channel coast, and we had a pause when we enjoyed life very much. Enjoying life in France as a soldier is an old tradition of German armies.
With France forced to agree an armistice, Hitler could hardly restrain his glee. But what now? What to do about the British? What were his options?
One was to starve us out, submarine warfare. take a long time. Two was to destroy all our sources of production, factories and so on. That would also take a long time. Or invade, destroy Fighter Command and land in this country.
Hitler considered his options with his commanders. In fact, they had only one, invasion. The Germans' problem was their relative weakness at sea. They didn't have enough ships to confront the British Royal Navy. All Hitler could do was to harry British convoys from the air using the Luftwaffe, a weapon that had led his thrust through Europe. But would it be the right weapon to defeat the British?
Of course, pretty soon, auxiliary airfields were built along the channel in France. Troops were moved there, and the gossip went around, it's going to be Britain pretty soon. And we were discussing already, do we have the right instrument? There was no concept even how to fight the battle, bearing in mind the short range of the bombers, the very limited load, and the short range of the fighters. As an instrument, it was only part of an air force.
The Luftwaffe existed to support the German army. Now, it would have to operate on its own.
Your flight level?
We'll be at 500 feet for the entire attack.
Yes.
How's the weather?
It looks quite good. We might get some problem with the cloud on the higher ground here.
As Hitler planned the next battle, he decided to bully Britain towards the conference table. The last thing he wanted was a long war.
The intention was to bring England to a point in which England would agree to a peace talks. But Hitler, he talked to me on the occasion when I got the first higher decoration, and he said, I don't like the war against England. I'm forced to fight, but I don't like it.
Perhaps Hitler truly thought he would get away without a fight. Yet, throughout the 1930s, the British had been developing a defensive air strategy.
Flying was very different in those days. It was very much more an amateur, seat-of-the-pants sort of activity. And it wasn't hedged in by rules and regulations. You didn't have to be a brilliant technologist and understand computers and all these extraordinary things you do nowadays. You just had to get an airplane and go.
Among the enthusiastic flyers was Peter Townsend. He learned to fly at school.
I was so mad about flying. It was such a pure, clean, and wonderful thing that in 37, when things were really getting bad on the political scene, I was so horrified. You may think I was oversensitive, but I was so horrified that the idea that my passion for flying would lead me into killing people that I actually tried to get out of the Air Force.
The RAF learned the bitter lessons of air combat during the Battle for France. In 6 weeks, the British lost half their operational aircraft. Most keenly, they felt the loss of experienced pilots, many of them trained in auxiliary units like the university air squadrons. Young men who joined without a thought of war. But once in the RAF, they'd stayed to make it their career.
So I'm doing low level next, and then
that should be quite good, really.
In 1936, Chris Foxley-Norris went to Oxford University.
Perhaps you can actually shoot down, hit tanks 5 miles away.
I arrived from a very monastic public school, son of a widowed mother, and I knew nothing of the opposite sex. And I went to a tea party in the Banbury Road and saw something that caught my eye. And I said to a friend of mine, what is that? And he said, that's a girl. So I said, well, how do you set about getting one of those? And he said, well, it helps if you have a motor car. And I didn't have any money. Ah, he said, if they'll take you in the University Air Squadron, you will be commissioned in the reserve of Air Force officers. And I did, and they did, and I got the car, and I got the girl, because I had £25, and a good car in those days, Lee Francis, I bought, cost £12. I eventually sold it for £13.
Pilots came to join the RAF from all over the English-speaking world. South Africa, Australia, New Zealand, Canada. There were even a handful of Americans.
As a matter of fact, when I joined the RAF, he said, then there is a question of pay. It's 7 and 6 a day to start with. And I was very upset because I said, I'm afraid I've lost everything I have and I can't afford 7 and 6 a day. And he said, no, no, we pay you. And I can remember thinking, these lovable fools, I can fly a Spitfire and they're going to pay me for it. I thought that was just wonderful.
Contrary to popular myth, not all pilots were rich or wore silk scarves or flew Spitfires. A third of all pilots were sergeants, equally brave, equally responsible in the air, but on the ground segregated by rank into different messes in a curious confirmation of the British class system. Whatever their rank, most of the Battle of Britain pilots in any case flew Hurricanes. Where the fighting was thickest, where the combat was fiercest, Hurricanes outnumbered Spitfires by 2 to 1, and they were reliable to the last.
The great tribute I can pay to it is that it would come back and get you back home with all sorts of bits missing, and it was built like the 4th Bridge. It'd take a tremendous amount of punishment. On one occasion, I had a hole in one wing which a man could have fallen through. Nevertheless, that aircraft came back and behaved very well, landed more or less as though nothing was wrong.
The Luftwaffe's prime weapon, as it was throughout the race through Europe, was the Stuka dive bomb. By early July, it was attacking British coasters as they butted up the channel with their vital but humdrum cargoes. The attacks were borne with tremendous bravery by ordinary merchant seamen.
The Stukas were coming out of the sun and diving at you. And you hear the scream, and then they let go their bombs or aerial torpedoes. You had a gut feeling that this might be it. And luckily that they just miss you, and you even saw a relief.
The Germans called it the Canal Kampf, the battle over the channel. For both sides, it was a costly prelude.
If you were too low, you had to go and ditch the aircraft. And this was a very dangerous affair, because everybody knows that when you hit the sea at maybe 100 miles an hour, it's like a brick wall. I had time to bail out. But it was a pretty dicey business, really, because the air sea rescue was not well organized. And as I went down, I looked everywhere for a ship, and I couldn't see one anywhere. And at the last moment, there was this little trawler. The first thing they did was to bring half a glass of rum to me. And I said, after all, not at this time, please. So I sipped at it a little bit. Then I had breakfast with them down below, rum for breakfast. Then more rum, and I almost washed my teeth in rum. And by the time I tottered ashore, well, I could hardly stand up, and I had to present myself to a naval officer and tell him that I was the commanding officer of 85 Squadron, which he had some difficulty in believing.
Dover, only 21 miles from the coast of France, became known as Hellfire Corner. The town quivered below its ancient fortifications. Pubs with a view were haunted by journalists who found increasing material for daily reports. Reg Forster filed stories for the Daily Herald.
The most furious air battle Britain has yet seen raged for more than an hour over the channel yesterday. 100 German bombers and fighters swooped on a convoy, unleashing hundreds of bombs. 3 of the raiders were shot down by Spitfire.
For the first time, British civilians found themselves in the front line. Dover and Folkestone, Hastings and Brighton, Portsmouth and Southampton were strafed, shelled and bombed. British propaganda films assured everyone that life was going on as normal.
Yes, Dover's all right. It looks intact, The town's still there. The harbour's still there. This is the main street. No cowering citizens here. The shops are open and busy. The buses still run. And the police have plenty of traffic to control. And the little things of life still go on. This lady feeds the gulls every morning as she's done for years.
Presumably stepping over the mines. The fishing fleet still sailed, however, and Britain was glad of it. Many foods were rationed, but not fish. You could get as much as you wanted, provided the fishermen survived to bring back their catch.
The powers that be were getting very worried about that, the food situation. So they wanted all the fish you could get. You could move about quite easy, apart from the German plane fly with everything they got left, you know. They couldn't hit us, we were too small to hit.
Well, so it was too bad a shot.
They used to fire just indiscriminately, you know, they didn't worry. And we always said, well, they got to get rid of the bullets, couldn't take him home to Hitler, he wouldn't like it.
Hitler admitted he was mystified. Why wouldn't Britain take the obvious course and make peace? He pressed ahead with invasion plans under the codename Sea Lion. Then, in the Kroll Opera House in Berlin, he made a final appeal to reason. The response was blunt.
Hitler makes a contribution to our waste paper campaign by giving us our first leaflet raid. However, there are no complaints. We can do with all the paper we can get, even though it is made in Germany. There are various uses to which Hitler's leaflets may be put. For example, shaving paper.
In households all over the country, there were new routines to get used to. In the south, families tried living all day in their air raid shelters.
During the morning, the mums would collect the vegetables, take them down the shelter to peel. We would do mending, crochet, anything that we wanted to do down there if it was a bad day.
Rationing began to bite. Atlantic convoys suffered heavy losses and imported foods and materials dwindled.
The meat at one time went down to 10 pence a week per person and perhaps 2 pence of the corned beef. Sausages weren't rationed. Offal wasn't rationed, but you had to get there in time. You had to register with one shop. So they knew how many customers they'd got. They were delivered that amount of meat and they were able to cut the meat exactly to the penneth, which was clever, because they never could otherwise.
Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. If we can stand up to him, all Europe may be freed, and the life of the world may move forward into broad, sunlit upland.
Winston Churchill's message was clear. Whatever Hitler hoped, there would be no conciliation. By mid-July, the RAF were building aircraft faster than the Luftwaffe, and German military production was not making good the losses of successive campaigns. Hitler's early advantage was slipping away. He called for Göring and ordered his Reichsmarschall to prepare a massive bombing offensive. German propaganda film reflects his aim, to launch a Nazi crusade which would annihilate the RAF, win control of the skies, and enable an invasion. It was called the Adlerangriff, the Eagle Attack. Britain waited. The first 2 weeks of August 1940 were bad for the British. The Luftwaffe had closed the channel to daylight convoys. On the 8th of August, the British tried to push a convoy through, and the Luftwaffe pounced.
I noticed a very awe-inspiring clump of enemy aircraft coming along our way, stretching all the way back to the Cherbourg Peninsula. For a few seconds before we joined together, one felt like laughing at the incongruity of the total situation. As six of us against that mob, it was like throwing the Christians to the lions.
The Germans scored their biggest triumph of the whole Channel battle. Half the convoy was lost or damaged. The man in charge of the Luftwaffe, Hermann Göring, was cock-a-hoop. The forthcoming Eagle attack would be a glorious duel, a joust in the skies.
Göring was a-technical, a man who even hated technique. He was thinking in terms of World War I, biplanes, dogfighting, and things like that.
He could be a charming host, but when it came to strategic and tactical questions in air war, he didn't have the right understanding.
When the war had started, he became already pompous, was getting fat. His interest was not the Luftwaffe. As a military leader already joined the battle, he was useless, if not an amateur.
It's hard to think of anyone less like Göring than Air Marshal Sir Hugh Dowding, the man in charge of Britain's air defence. He was withdrawn, almost mystic, known throughout the service as Stuffy. It was an appropriate nickname.
Oh yes, he's really stuffy. I got to know him very, very well, especially later after the war. He was a chap who didn't smile very often. He's very, very economical with his praise. And his eyes were his best indication. If he looked at you, he didn't smile anything at all. You knew, okay, you're acceptable. If he showed signs of boredom, you want to get out. Occasionally, you get a little smile in the end of his mouth, you know. But he was a terribly honest, firm man.
For 3 years, Dowding had been piecing together a technical and organizational jigsaw. With scant support from his superiors, he'd decided to exploit some extraordinary new technology.
He would never refuse to listen to anybody with a new idea. At the same time, he had to prove it was so. And when the radar suggestion was made by Watt, Stuffy did something nobody's ever done before. He went to the British Treasury and said, I want £1 million, and got it.
With it, he built a network of radar stations along the coast. Dowding's brilliant idea was to link them to a central control, which would assess the incoming information, collate it, and issue a pattern of orders to intercept the enemy. 50 years on, those who defend British airspace work to much the same strategy and timescale.
The principles haven't changed. The speed that aeroplanes flew in 1940 is significantly slower than the speeds that aircraft fly today. However, the detection ranges that we got from the radars were also significantly shorter than we get today. So we've got about the same time to chase and to hide and to defend the UK as they had in 1940. The principles are identical. The time is virtually identical.
In 1940, what Churchill described as Stone Age technology picked up the raids once they approached the coast. The outposts were manned by the Royal Observer Corps.
Well, quite simple, really. You saw the planes coming, and you estimate the heights for a start. Right, we say it's at 10,000, or they are. You'd set this at 10,000, and this is a bit stiff now. Would be after 50 years, I suppose. And then sight the aircraft with it and get on it. And I would be using the instrument, and my mate here, he would have the telephone, and wherever that pointer was over, he would send through the grid reference of that particular spot.
For some strange reason, probably to cause the most panic, the Germans sent their aircraft over breakfast time, lunch time, and tea time. And of course, you're just sitting there for your meal, and the marines would go off.
Got a TriStar tank.
Back at Central Control, Dowding's system took the information, built a strategic picture, and then instructed sector controllers to scramble the squadrons.
Exercise engaged. 2-1, your bogey, trailman, 100, 30 miles. 2-1, your target speed, decimal 95.
As you target north-south.
2-0, it's lost tally. Snap, 260.
Box one in the third.
Roger, no kill on the frontal.
He had no model. Nobody before had ever built or built an air defence system or fought an air defence war. He had sensors, he had a command and control system, he had communications to tie the two together, and that was complemented by a brilliant aeroplane and some very brave pilots. Tying it all together in the way that he did was, in some ways, a stroke of genius.
The meaning of this tool or this system for aircraft detection was never penetrated our mind. When we started mostly, we assembled with the bombers over Cap Grenet, and always the Spitfires were up looking down at us already in time. And we discussed afterwards, how can this happen? How do they know?
British radar masts were in plain view, but the Germans gave them little priority. They made only one serious attempt to knock them out. On August 12th, the Junkers 88s of the Edelweiss bomber wing were given Ventnor radar as their target. They took off from Orly near Paris. Towards noon, they were spotted, first by radar and then by the Observer Corps near Brighton. One of the pilots on the raid was Friedrich Aufdenkamp.
Ich hatte bereits mal die Idee, also kurz vor dem Angriff war die erste Gruppe oder die ersten Flugzeuge hatten bereits gestürzt und ich war ziemlich hinten am Schwanz, am Ende und konnte denn beim Sturz konnte ich nur noch den Turm des Fernsehsenders sehen. Also wo meine Bomben eigentlich richtig gelegen haben, das kann ich eigentlich nicht recht sagen, weil das alles in Rauch und Qualm gehüllt war.
The radar was hit, but the German High Command didn't realize the importance of their achievement. They never again attempted to put out the eyes of the British defense system. It was a terrible miscalculation. Adlertag, Eagle Day, finally dawned. Goering had promised to annihilate the RAF in 3 days. Now the targets were airfields in the green downlands of southern England. It was on Eagle Day that, for the first time, crucial weaknesses in Luftwaffe planning and communications were exposed. Some lumbering bombers simply couldn't find their vital fighter escorts. Others watched as their escorts waggled their wings and disappeared. They'd been recalled, but nobody told the bombers.
We didn't need a Battle of Britain to see that the Air Force was not correctly equipped for this mission. We didn't even have a communication, a radio communication between bombers and fighters. We didn't have the same frequency. We couldn't talk to each other.
The first 2 days of the Eagle attack were bad for the Luftwaffe. The third day was even worse. Units based in Norway were thrown in to bomb the airfields of Scotland and the northeast.
I think everybody's saying, well, it's about our turn. It was fairly quiet, no big raids or anything at all off the northeast coast. And of course, when we did see them, it was a very large formation indeed. There was just stacked one layer after a layer. And Ted Graham, who was the acting SAO at the time, had a bit of a stutter, and we were saying, Ted, can't you see them? And he said, well, of course I can, I'm just trying to work out what to bloody well do. I got up behind one that had it looked like a bomb underneath it, and I closed up and hit it, and it just blew up completely.
In a single day, a fifth of the raiding force was lost, and the Norwegian-based units never again flew in strength against Britain. In the south, the pace of the battle quickened.
Air fighting is a funny thing in that it's very detached. I never felt that I was fighting human beings.
You burn very quickly, it's fantastic. Basically got the hood open, I'd undone my belt and pulled the old jack out, and then she blew up. I went sailing up, not down, up in flames. When the flames disappeared, there was nothing. Nothing at all, no aircraft, nothing.
There was a District 110, and I thought, this is a sitting duck with my name written all over it. And right up behind him, about to fire, when his small brother, a 109, hit me in the cockpit and in the tail.
We could see the Spitfires or Hurricanes coming out of the clouds. We looked at the sun, here's the sun, now let's go here. And then taking up speed, nicht? In before attacking. And so we tried to catch them.
In one moment, you're in the middle of this incredible whirling mass of aircraft. And the sky was full of tracer bullets, and there were aircraft on fire, no damaged aircraft, no parachutes. And then suddenly, like by magic, the sky would clear, and we'd be back to an ordinary, nice, peaceful English summer afternoon with nothing in the sky at all.
Many more people were now caught up in the battle.
These planes were going up, and my wife was just here somewhere, and she went running out and waved to them because they were below the height of where our house is, and she was couldn't see that there were German markings, and she'd waved to them very brightly, and within seconds they'd open up, shooting up the Elam station. We laughed about it for many, many times after that. Come on. I remember one day I was taking a shortcut back to the farm.
Come on.
And I was in the middle of this field when this battle started overhead. And I felt rather like an oyster that had been opened, and I couldn't get any shelter. So I hurried a bit, and I stood beside a post which had been left in the middle of the field. And I felt perfectly safe when I got to that post, and I watched this battle. And as far as I can remember, you know, nothing was shot down on that occasion.
Goering's dive bombers, the Stukas, were used to hit coastal airfields. Sometimes they caught the RAF on the ground. On August 16th, they attacked Tangmere. 602 Squadron was off base having lunch.
We raced along, and before we got to the airfield, there were bits of shrapnel falling around us. And there were the ground crews, bless their hearts. They had reacted immediately. And I must say, I was very surprised when I got down, because I'd never seen them all wearing tin hats. But you could hear all the shrapnel bouncing off them. They got us into our aircraft, and we took off in the middle of all this melee. We didn't wait to form up or anything. They were taking off from all corners of the field. How we didn't collide, I don't know. One of our chaps, as he was just taking off, a Stuka came down, dived down in front of him, and he shot him down before he'd even got his wheels up.
When the aircraft used to come back from a sortie, the first thing that used to be announced over the tannoy was what the score was. Had we lost anybody? Better still, had we put down any of the enemy? And this was always greeted with a great cheer throughout the hangar. You know.
Key ground crew had learned all there was to know about airframes, engines and armament at RAF Halton.
What part of your training is this?
This is a T-22. This is flying controls.
Their skill of hand was such that I've always said that you could put a few ex-apprentices down in any situation, no matter how bad it was, and they would find a way out of it purely by improvising.
Make and mend skills meant British planes were rarely long on the ground. They could be patched up in a field and in the air again within hours. August the 18th was a critical day in the battle. Goering attacked the airfields again. This time, the RAF were ready for them, and the Stukas proved desperately vulnerable.
Well, I can put it in a nutshell, they were my favourite target. One of the great difficulties in air fighting is you very quickly run out of all ammunition. And so if you've got a target, which the Ju-87 is, that the moment you hit it, it bursts into flames at the wing root. And once that's started, you're sure that you've got it.
the Stuka in his tactics to attack a target could not be escorted, could not be protected by fighters, because they were coming one after the other from the sky, and they were diving, and close to the ground, they had to assemble again. So it was a difficult, it was an impossible target for the fighters to protect.
Goering was forced to withdraw the Stukas from the battle altogether. It was a serious blow, the defeat of the terror weapon which had hammered country after country, from France to Poland.
And we always remember Poland, and we always wanted to go back to it. That's why we fought with such sacrifices. That's why our losses were sometimes more than was absolutely necessary.
Before they were allowed to fly with the RAF, Polish pilots learned English radio procedure in a rather unorthodox fashion.
Float
up number three.
Of November.
How old were you when you...
When?
How old were you?
21.
When you seen the swastika or black cross on an aircraft, your heart beating gets much quicker, and you decided that you must get him or you get shot yourself. It's a feeling of absolute vengeance.
Towards the end of August, the battle changed character. The first assault by the Germans had failed. It now became a war of attrition. Who would last the longer? Time and again, heavily escorted bomber formations swept over the coast, penetrating further inland before splitting up to seek their targets. Time and again, British fighters were scrambled to meet them.
The longer it went on, of course, we began to lose people, either shot down and killed or injured, and we were getting very, very short of pilots, and we were put on a very high state of alert, which meant that we were having to sleep by the aircraft day and night. And it was not uncommon to find chaps coming down, having been in action, coming into the crew room, taking off their flying kit as much as they were able to, flop down on a really old wooden chair and fall fast asleep within a minute.
For the Germans, too, the days were long, hot and bitter.
We'd had a very hard day. We spent the night together, drinking just half a bottle of champagne, I remember. We were in a bad mood because we had lost friends. And so we went to bed with the order to start very early the next day. And none of us could sleep, nor could I. I stood up, went to the library, picked up the book, and I found the poem, which I knew in German, "Wer immer weint in der Welt, weint für mich." And it moved me very much.
The next day, Paul Temme was shot down in a sortie over England. The relentless raids were beginning to tell on British civilians. Ramsgate on the Kent coast lay in the flight path of the German bombers. It was all pretty demoralising.
A great lot of people had left Ramsgate. In fact, it was nearly empty, except for essential services, you know.
But some citizens decided not to go. Instead, they took up residence in tunnels in the cliff built in the first weeks of the war by the local council.
I remember vividly coming down Ellington Road, where there were two tunnels, entrances in the park, in Ellington Park, and seeing this mist coming out early in the morning. And I went over and smelt it, and it had a smell of damp chalk and fried bacon, you know. You can imagine the smell of damp chalk and fried bacon. And it was quite noticeable.
It became the job of George Poynter, a citizen of Ramsgate, to trundle a steamroller along the road to nearby Manston Airfield to help fill in the craters left by constant bombing.
Yes, it was quite a brave move, considering that these dogfights were going on, and one might have broke away and had to go at the solitary steamroller going along to the field. And I watched him go up the road rather. I thought, oh dear. Good luck to your point.
On August 30th, a hit on the main supply cable knocked out all the radar in Kent. The detection system failed and the bombers got through to one of the RAF's key fighter strips at Biggin Hill.
I can remember coming out at somewhere about 5:30 one evening or one afternoon, and there was a raid just starting, and we dived for cover. And there were two very big shelters right opposite the airmen's mess, and these were absolutely crammed full of not only of airmen, soldiers, WAF, ATS. And when the raid was over, walking back to the hangar, I suddenly came across these two very big craters with literally bits of bodies just in every direction.
The next day, Biggin Hill was attacked again.
When the bomb actually hit onto the ops room itself, it was a case really of getting out because it obviously would have caught fire. So we got out, and the sentry had been badly hurt, but somebody looked after him. And we dusted ourselves down and sort of threw ourselves down on a bit of ground, and then a warrant officer shouted to us, "Get up, get up." We couldn't think why, and he said, "You're against an unexploded bomb." So we gently moved away from there. And we went up to the emergency ops room in Biggin Hill Village in a butcher's shop. And there we carried on with a blackboard and chalk instead of the full table, and it really worked remarkably well.
But Biggin Hill had suffered a near mortal blow. The vital network of telephone lines connecting it to the air defence system had been cut to shreds. Britain's entire defence system was in acute peril.
Another 2 or 3 days of attack on Biggin Hill could have been quite catastrophic. Had Biggin Hill been lost, there would have been a corridor, an open corridor, stretching from the north coast of France straight into London, and nobody else could have filled it.
September began, and soon autumn gales would close the English Channel to invaders. Time was running out for Hitler and for Sea Lion. Then, as now, spy planes pried into enemy plans with high-level photography. Piece by piece, they hoped to develop a picture of the other side's strategy. Now the pictures are on the table 4 minutes after the planes land. 50 years ago, it was a very experimental exercise.
We had to learn the hard way because these things had never been done before. We had no proper clothing for high level. We had no proper oxygen masks. We had no heating. Everything had to be learned slowly. No navigation aids, no guns. We weren't fighting a battle. We were gathering intelligence. If we started to fight a battle, we wouldn't get back. Our job was to get back. If not, we were successful. Between August the 28th and September the 7th, the build-up in Dunkirk of barges and craft alone was from naught in August 28th to about 290 by September the 7th. And we were asked to continually photograph the channel ports twice a day to keep an eye on the build-up of the ships.
More than 1,900 barges had been requisitioned from Germany's inland waterways. Hitler had only a week left to make a decision, but he couldn't commit these craft and his army to the North Sea without adequate air cover. Now, British bombers, acting on the intelligence gathered, flew to smash the invasion fleet as it lay in Channel ports. They fought their way through, but suffered heavy losses. German cameras record the death of a Blenheim, from first hit to final conflagration. Jargon, patter, curses and cries captured by the Y service, then top secret, even now little known. This was intelligence gathering by the nuns. WAFs closeted in secret hideouts listening to the German fighter pilots as they flew against Britain.
My German was very limited and I was pushed to really understand anything. I was very grateful if I got anything down at all. It improved as the days went on. But I didn't know what I was listening to, and I just literally wrote down what I heard, which was jargon.
Oscar Papa, thank you. Contact London 128.
Oscar Papa, that sounds almost familiar. Sounds familiar.
Advil 2, eastward for Gatwick, landing on 2-6 left, Hawk 6-7, 2-3,
Ardett.
Yes.
One of the first phrases I had in RT, in speech, was, yet sind wir über Hawkingham. We are over Hawkinge. Oh, Indiana, aufpassen. Indiana, enemy aircraft, aufpassen, take care. They were very brief, wasn't a long conversation. It was just, it shouldn't have been talking anyhow. And they were just impatient, excited little gasps.
On the ground, the civilians took more than a passing interest in the battle overhead. After all, a stricken aircraft is a lethal, uncontrolled weapon.
I was hanging out the bedroom window in the front, looking at a terrible battle over Hawkinge, and feeling rather disgusted because there were commentators who were describing it as though it were a football match, which I thought was a very unkind attitude.
Sometimes we'd see about 9 or 12 Spitfires and Hurricanes going out to meet hundreds of German planes. And then as they grew nearer, you could hear the growling noise. The Germans had an uneven note, sort of wum, 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 wum. My uncle used to say it was, where do you want it? Where do you want it?
Now, at last, Goering got what he'd always wanted, the orders to attack London.
Der Großangriff auf London nimmt seinen Anfang. Der Gefechtsstand des Reichsmarschalls.
In fact, it was all a mistake. The Germans had, in error, unloaded a number of bombs on the outskirts of London. When, in retaliation, the British bombed Berlin, Hitler was enraged. No longer would he hit the airfields, he said. Now, London would be the target. Goering watched his armada set out.
The 7th of September, I'll never forget, because it was a very warm, cloudless sky, but there was a very thick haze that rose up to something like 17,000 feet. And of course, we came through this haze, the first squadron to come through. And I couldn't believe my eyes. There was hundreds and hundreds of German aircraft coming in. I've never, as far as you looked, there were just wave after wave, and on top of them were the escorting fighters, 109s and 110s. I've never seen so many aircraft in all my life in the air at one time. And it was then it suddenly dawned on me that they were attacking London. And if they were going to do that, that relieved the pressure on the fighter stations. It was terrible for the Londoners, and that saved the day for us.
500 tons of bombs pounded London, but the change of target lost Hitler the battle. His Reichsmarschall had unleashed Loge, the god of fire. But he'd underestimated the resilience of the RAF and the Londoners' ability to take it.
When we got there, we found the whole dock was blazing furiously from end to end.
It was an appalling fire. In normal times, it would have taken about 100 or 150 pumps to surround it, confine it, and kill it.
As a sunny Saturday afternoon turned into a nightmare, the men and women of the London Fire Brigade found themselves dealing with an inferno.
The fire alarm went, and Station Officer Knight went on, and he got the message back to me. He said, "Send me every bloody pump you've got, the whole bloody world's on fire." That was when we first realised just how bad it was.
We were ungefähr vielleicht 50 oder 30 Kilometer von der französischen Kanalküste. Da färbte sich der Himmel vor uns schon rot. Und da sagte der Oberleutnant, ich hatte einen Oberleutnant von Claire in der Maschine, Mensch, das ist doch bestimmt London.
Wave after wave of bombers flew in. They continued to come through the late afternoon and on into the night.
When you looked out, there's the firemen up the ladders, absolutely silhouetted against the flames. The flames were, I don't know how many feet high. And you'd see one minute they'd be there and the next minute they were on the ground where perhaps they'd shot them, whatever they'd done. It was really a terrible sight, and it was a terrible thing.
And we didn't know what was happening. And all of a sudden, out of the warehouse came thousands and thousands and thousands of rats. They were running from the burning building, and they filled the little dockyard, the little wharf, completely, and then we jumped for the ladders as well. They made no attempt. They just passed through the entrance to the dock and moved off down Cable Street, filling it from wall to wall, Anthony. And that was the last we saw of them.
Ganz London war übersät von Einzelfeuer, von Großfeuern. Teilweise stand über London über einigen größeren Feuer stand ein regelrechter Feuerkumuli, so eine große Wolke, nicht wahr? Die wurde von unten wieder rot angeleuchtet. Das war ein grauenhafter Anblick.
Everything was on fire. And it was the same the other side of the river. But the worst thing over the river was later on, when a block of flats fell, it was a direct hit, and I don't know how many were in those flats, but they were screaming and crying all night. It was really awful. We couldn't, there was nothing anybody could do.
This was the first night of the London Blitz. 57 consecutive nights of bombing would follow. Goering was convinced that he'd triumphed. London was flattened, he said. Invasion must be imminent. Throughout the country, but especially on the south coast, rumour and counter-rumour ran rife.
We were lying in bed and we heard an engine. Quite quiet, you know. And my husband said, "I think we'd better get up." He said, "I think it's the invasion." But then we realised when we did get up, we had our bags packed. We'd already got them packed. We always had those standing by. And he said, "I think I'd better go and report it."
And report it he did. In nearby Lydd, there were more curious goings on. A stranger had gone into the pub at around breakfast time to ask for a drink. A little later,
my husband went down to the pub for a drink. And when he went in there, the landlady came to him and said, "I wonder if you'd mind coming into the other bar. There's a man who tried to get in here before opening hours." And she said when he ordered his drink, he studied his money very carefully before paying it.
The police were alerted and they searched the area. They found three other men and a radio transmitter. It was clear that the men were all spies.
The security men came and asked him questions, and he said his name was Karl Meyer, that he was a Dutch refugee, and then he was just taken off, and later, of course, he appeared at the Old Bailey, and he was eventually executed.
Mm-hmm. the invasion began. All along the coast, Home Guard and regular soldiers sprang to defensive positions on hearing the code word, Cromwell. It was a false alarm, but everyone was urged to be prepared, and they had specific orders, including the women of Y service.
They said the defence schemes did not involve taking care of Beachy Head, so that when we went on watch, especially at night, we must prepare to be abandoned. And everybody had great ideas of what they were going to take. I actually took a small bottle of brandy. But one girl insisted on taking her tennis racket because it was new. And another girl wanted to take a water pistol.
The family at Sissinghurst Castle had no illusions about their fate if the Nazis invaded.
We were very close to the coast here, where if the invasion had taken place, we would have been immediately in the front line. And anticipating that, my mother and father both provided themselves with a poison pill, which they called, in Shakespeare's famous words, the bear bodkin, literally to commit suicide.
Much later, after the war, a black book was discovered. On its pages, not simply leading politicians such as Nicholson, but hundreds, Jews and Gentiles, whom Hitler felt would oppose him.
He had some very unpleasant plans for English men in particular, aged from 17 to 50. And he'd appointed a very nasty man called Professor Six, whose headquarters were designated as being in London. Professor Six later became, of course he didn't get the job in England, but he got a similar job in Russia, where he was known for his torturing and terrible deeds of cruelty.
The crucial day of the battle proved to be September the 15th. Goering staked every squadron in a last attempt to annihilate the RAF. But thanks to the decision to switch the attack to London, the RAF and the airfields had a week to recover. They were ready to meet the raiders.
Als die ersten Kampfflieg-Einsätze Richtung London geflogen wurden und wir als Begleitschutz eingesetzt waren, da regnete es Spitfire und Hurrikan vom Himmel. Und da die Kampfverbände feldmäßig langsam flogen, mussten wir also in dauernden Eiertänzen wechselnd hin und her uns bemühen, an die Kampfverbände dran zu bleiben. Eine zu spät anerkannte Kurve nach links oder rechts führten dazu, dass oft der Jagdverband abriss. Und da musste man eilen, um wieder ranzukommen. Denn diese Lücken haben die Fighter Pilots von England genau mitgekriegt.
All too soon, German fighters were out of fuel and forced to return to base. The bombers became easy prey. Raiders reached their target and bombed London at random through gaps in the cloud. Buckingham Palace was hit twice. Early that afternoon, Londoners watched a Dornier in furious single-handed combat with a Hurrikan. Finally, Ray Holmes, the pilot of the Hurrikan, ran out of ammunition and tried to ram the German bomber.
I continued on and I tried to clip his tail off, but the whole of the tail took my wings and I went out of control. The first thing I saw were railway lines which were running into Victoria Station. I thought, well, now I'm going to get electrocuted. And I swung across the road and hit the roof of those houses down below, slithered down the roof, landed in a dustbin with my parachute draped over a drain pipe. I jumped out of the dustbin, and there were two girls in the garden next door, and I was feeling very relieved to be on the ground safe and sound, and I jumped over the fence and kissed them both.
The Dornier crashed into Victoria Station. One of her crew landed a mile away in Kennington Park.
We were sitting in the flat and we heard this noise. Everybody was cheering and shouting. We looked out the window and we saw this parachute coming down. Of course, everybody was chasing the park, you know, chasing where the park was going to land, because it was that near. My sister ran out and she followed it, and she actually saw the pilot. She said he was only about 17, and everybody wanted to get hold of him, but the ARP got him and handed him over to two policemen who took him to the local police station.
What would they have done to him?
Well, they would have killed him if they'd have got hold of him. Well, we all felt that way. I mean, what we'd been through.
So what had gone wrong? The fatal error had occurred half an hour earlier while the raid was forming up over France.
We assembled over Cap Grenet. The bomber force was about 400, 450 German bombers. They were too late, 5 minutes, so we had not enough endurance. We escorted them towards London. We had to leave the bomber convoy too early and left them alone. The Spitz came down. The whole thing was a catastrophe.
Luftwaffe flew on into the afternoon, only to be met by an air force that they'd been told were defeated. In the lull between sorties, the British fighters were able to rearm and refuel. Always, it seemed, they were ready to meet the next wave. Fighter control system was put to the ultimate test. Every squadron within reach was deployed. The man in charge of 11 Group HQ at Uxbridge was a New Zealander, Air Vice Marshal Keith Park.
He was quite a different character to stuff, you know, that he was full of fun. He flew aeroplane and had his own private hurricane. And the chaps worshipped him.
WAFs based at RAF Uxbridge replay the drama that took place in this bunker 50 years ago. This was also a day that Churchill chose to visit the control room.
September the 15th, he visited there with Lady Churchill, and Keith was there standing behind him. And after the last squadrons had gone off, he said, "What have you got left, Air Marshal Park?" And he said, "Nothing, sir. I've sent the lot off." And it's a wonderful thing, because history is full of people who hadn't the nerve to send their forces in.
It was a critical day. It also was my birthday, I remember well. For the first time we discussed, why don't we stop this nonsense? This cannot end in a very good way. The 15th of September for me was the deciding point, the climax of the whole battle.
They received the most catastrophic, thrashing defeat. And after that, Hitler realized that the Luftwaffe was not winning the battle. The Luftwaffe was essential to the invasion, and on the 17th, Hitler gave his famous five-word message saying that the invasion was postponed indefinitely.
The British were triumphant. The raids and dogfights continued well into October. The invasion threat was over. By losing the Battle of Britain, the Germans had lost their best chance of winning the war.
Once you were given the instructions to take off and you got airborne, you weren't frightened at all. It was exhilarating.
That they were brilliantly effective is a significant tribute to Lord Dowding, because he's the only man that ever won an air defence battle.
For England, it was a decisive battle.
I didn't see